So next topic we'll start with how to design a buck converter for a given specification. So far we talked about how you compensate, okay, and what are the different basically stages of in your buck converter, and how you go for small signal analysis. You have to linearize that each block, and like PWM gain and your compensator, each has to be replaced with its gain or transfer function, and then with that you can analyze a loop gain. So that is usually done with the behavioral model. Okay, so the way you start with, you first take the specification, okay, and then you use the ideal components, not the transistor level, for each block, and do your loop gain analysis and find all the parameters, like for compensation, if you are using op amp RC, what values of R and C will require, what gain for op amp, what kind of bandwidth you will require, okay, and then what sort of VM you for RAM generator you will be looking at for the given range of your Vin, and then beta also will come into picture if you are using GMC, otherwise not. Okay, so in order to do that, actually once you have finished that, you have to start replacing each block one by one using your transistor level, and which means what is the first thing you need to do for your converter? So let's say I am given only V in V out, nothing else. So there are two things in the spec: you might be given switching frequency, or you may not. So let's say somebody ask you, okay, I want this V in, and for this V in I want these values of V out. Okay, this is the range of V in, this is the range of V out. That's what I want. You decide everything else. That's the one way. Other way could be like if there is already a converter design, and you are looking for a replacement for the same in a, let's say, different technology. Okay, so that's another possibility. So in that case, you can take the switching frequency, LC values, everything from there, and simply port. But that is not like a designing from scratch. But if you are designing from scratch, then you have to decide your switching frequency, you have to decide the value of L and C before even you go into designing the designing each block at the transistor level. Okay, so in this flow, what we are going to learn: how you decide your switching frequency, how you choose your L and C component, and then after that, how you start designing each block one by one based on that spec. So all you will be given in the specification: your V in, V out, your ripple spec, your transient response, what kind of transient response you are looking for, which means your undershoot, overshoot for both line and load. You will be given your line and load regulation. Okay, so these are the specs which you will be given, and you have to design for those specifications your DC-DC converters. So first step, what you are given in the DC-DC converter when you are designing is the specifications. V in, V out, then line and load regulation. Load transient. Triple. What else? accuracy. Load current. Okay, so these are the few specifications. You may be given more, like switching frequency, you may or may not. Switching may or so, if it's given, then it's pretty straightforward. Based on the ripple voltage, you choose L and C values. But if it's not given, then you have to do a little bit more exercise to find out what will be the optimum switching frequency for the voltage and load current you are designing for. So, these are the main specs which are usually given. So, the first step is, if switching frequency is given, then it is fine. If it is not given, then you have to find it. Ninth is efficiency. This also may or may not be given. So, if it is given, then you size your transistors and choose the inductors with the DCR values based on the efficiency. Otherwise, we usually target 90% and above. Okay. So, switching frequency L and C. So, since L and C is coupled to switching frequency, so usually when you are finding switching frequency, you find L and C same time you decide. So, what all specs we need to look at in order to find switching frequency? No, the ripple will depend on LC. So, the first thing you need to look at the efficiency. So, if your switching losses are high, you cannot arbitrarily choose 100 megahertz. So, let us say at 100 megahertz your switching losses are 10% and that 10% you are losing in the conduction loss. So, 20% is lost. So, efficiency will be 80%. So, you can never meet 90% efficiency target if you choose very high frequency. So, there is a trade-off between size of L and C and switching frequency, but that does not mean that you can arbitrarily choose very high frequency, because otherwise it will be difficult to meet the efficiency numbers. So, switching losses when do switching losses dominate? We discussed this at light load. And we are looking at a 90% at full load. What does it mean? Out of 10% loss, switching losses will be negligible. Okay. So, you should try to keep it less than 1% or so. Should be negligible at high load. Higher load currents. Okay. So, if my efficiency I am targeting greater than 90%, this means total loss is approximately 10%. Okay. So, let us say I am designing for Vin equal to 1.8 volt. Okay. V out equal to, let us say, 1.2 volt and I load equal to I load max 1 amp. Okay. So, which means the losses you have to calculate full load is at 1 amp. Okay. Because I know conduction losses will be maximum at 1 amp, I square R losses. So, your I load square into R loss is how much? Approximately 120 milliwatt. I mean, it won't be exactly 120 milliwatt. I am just calculating the 10% of the output. Okay, but usually when you, if you are exactly want to calculate, then you have to apply this formula. So, what is efficiency? P in over P out. So, P in is unknown, but P out we know. Sorry, P out by P in. So, P in is unknown, but P out we know is 1.2 watt. Okay. So, I can write this P out over P out plus P loss, correct. So, what is P loss? If from here I want to calculate, what will be the P loss? 1 minus 1 over. So, let us do this. P out, I can write this 1 plus P loss over P out equal to 1 over, correct. So, this implies P loss equal to 1 minus 1 over into P out, correct. So, zeta is 0.9. 1 by eta minus 1 by eta. Okay. So, this is 1 over 0.9 minus 1 into P out. So, roughly you will get same number around 10%. Okay. This will give you, I think, how much? 11%?
11.1%.
Okay. So, if you want to calculate the exact number, you can apply this formula. Otherwise, roughly it will always come 10%. If it is 90%, then 10% of your total power dissipated. So, there will be maybe 1% error or so. But upfront, if you want to tell, then that should be the number. Okay, so this comes around close to 11%. So, 11% of your 1.2 watt. How much? 132 milliwatt. Okay. So, this is the total loss you can incur in your converter, okay. And this should include all conduction losses, switching losses, your quiescent loss, everything, okay. And what is P loss? P loss total? P loss conduction plus P loss switching plus P loss what? P loss AC what? P loss AC?
Magnetic loss.
Magnetic loss. When I say P loss switching, it includes all the switching losses. Okay. magnetic plus P loss. What gate drive will be coming under switching? This P loss switching, when I am saying it includes gate drive, it includes your dead time losses, everything, okay. But P loss magnetic is external, which is coming from inductor, that is why I am writing it separately. You have a quiescent loss, huh? P loss, I will call it IQ, okay, or just call it Q. So, at higher load current, P loss con should be dominant, okay. But if you remember, there was one more switching loss, which was depending on your load current, okay. You remember the triangular waveform due to the finite on time associated with your, okay, hard switching losses. But usually what happens, those are dominant when you are using external power FET, because their gate cap is order of nanofarads, okay, so they have a larger delay. But when you are using on chip transistors, that delay is quite negligible. So your dominant will be the gate losses there, not that one. And since we are using 180 nanometer process for this, for those, you know, delay associated with MOSFETs is not that large. But when you use external FET, those FETs are rated for like 50 volt, 60 volt kind of thing. So they are more dominant if you are using a discrete power electronics kind of implementation you are doing, then they usually consider. But in on-chip implementation, usually those losses are not that high, okay. So, P loss conduction should be 90% of total loss, okay. So, when I say 90%, which means P loss conduction approximately 90% of 130. Roughly 120 milliwatt, okay. So, left over is how much? 10%, so, P loss minus P loss conduction is approximately 12 milli, okay.